Well, good morning, everybody. I welcome all the students, including the respected dignitaries. I am Devabroto Mukherjee, Education Officer of Birla Industrial and Technological Museum. Every year on 5th June, we celebrate the day, organizing different educational activities throughout the day. But this year, it is well known to all that due to pandemic COVID-19 situation, we are unable to organize this event, this day in that manner. Still, we are observing the day through online activity by delivering a popular talk on the topic Footprints of Climate Change in Sundarbans by an eminent scientist who is present over here. And topic of the lecture is Footprints of Climate Change in Sundarbans. We are lucky enough to have Dr. Saurabh Kumar Dubey, Associate Researcher, Consultative Group on International Agriculture Research, CGIAR. Let me brief Dr. Dubey in brief. Dr. Saurabh Kumar Dubey, MSc in Zoology, PhD in Fisheries Sciences. Dr. Dubey graduated in Zoology from the University of Calcutta and obtained from the Vidyasagar University in India. As an applied research professional with project management skills, Dr. Dubey has more than 10 years experience in environmental science, research and development sector. His interest span across coastal ecosystem, mangroves, integrated coastal zone management, aquaculture, fisheries, climate change, organic certification, livelihoods, dynamics, gender and institution. As a researcher in various capacities, Dr. Dubey served many organizations of national and international repute like West Bengal, University of Animal and Fisheries Sciences, ICAR, Central Inland Fisheries Research Institute, the Marine Products Export Development Authority, International Water Association, Water Resources Investigation and Development Department, etc. He has worked and implemented different research projects cutting across grassroots and national scales. These range from development of climate resilient aquaculture, Indian Sundarban coastal region, biodiversity assessment of mangroves and its fauna in Indian Sundarban, community dependence and livelihoods on the coastal ecologically sensitive areas, ESAs, in Sundarban and Bhitakarnika mangroves forest, strengthening grassroots diplomacy for working on understanding sustainable livelihoods of Hilsa fishery development committees across India and Bangladesh. Mangrove plantation and restoration, organic shrimp aquaculture and its certification, integrated mangrove shrimp aquaculture, sustainable and community-based minor irrigation management to enhance agriculture-based livelihood. Dr. Dubey has created 30 peer-reviewed research papers, 5 book chapters, 2 extension manuals, and 2 policy briefs. Currently, he is affiliated with a CGIAR International Research Organization, the World Fish Center. Let me mention that this program is jointly organized by Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, a constituent unit of National Council of Science Museums, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and SEF, South Asian Forum for Environment. I am requesting now Dr. Dubey to start his speech. Dr. Dubey.
Thank you, Mr. Mukherjee, for your presentation and introducing me in such prestigious platform. And I really honored and privileged and also thankful to Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, National Council of Science Museum, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and also South Asian Forum for Environment for giving me this immense opportunity to present Sundarban before you. And I always love to talk about Sundarbans. And Sundarban, it is, and now Sundarban is very much relevant in the present changing climatic scenarios. So now I am sharing the presentation. So kindly let me know, is it visible or not? So is it visible?
Yes,
it is visible. On log view, do you see this? Yes, it's okay.
So today I'll be discussing about the climate change impact on the Indian Sundarbans, and my topic is entitled as Footprints of Climate Change in Sundarbans. So before entering the subject matter, means Sundarbans, so I want to introduce the largest basin of the Asia, that is Ganga, Brahmaputra and Meghna basin. And the Sundarban ecoregion is located in the tidally active lower deltaic plain of the Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna river basin, and it hosts the largest contiguous transboundary mangrove forest in the world. So you just seen in the pictures, and this part of Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna delta is formed nearly 5000 year ago by the silt carried out by the river Ganga, as well as the other tributaries like Mayurakshi, Damodar, Ojoy and Kasai. The mangrove forest act as a vital protective barrier, and that is protecting the mainland, our mainland, from the flooding, tidal waves and cyclone. And the present changing context, mangrove is the important element for climate regulation and climate mitigation. Now, what are the mangroves? I just introduced mangrove to the larger audience. So mangroves are the diverse group of salt tolerant plant communities, and it is basically grown in the tropical and subtropical intertidal regions in the world, and it is occurring between latitude 20 degree north to 38 degree south. The term mangrove describes both the ecosystem and as well as the species that it comprises, and it is well known for its unique structural and functional adaptation that coping with a harsh environment. It possesses a unique structural functional adaptation, like and it thrives in low saline condition, in oxygen deprived soil and regular tidal inundation. Am I audible or what?
Yes, audible.
Okay. So these adaptations include the aerial breathing roots called nematophores, the other root system like stilt roots, buttress, etc. And they have salt excreting leaves, and they use a unique reproductive strategies such as viviparity, so that they can disseminate their seed into the wild. And you can see in the global distribution of mangroves, and mangroves currently found in 123 countries worldwide, and it covers 80 numbers of unique plant species, and out of which 80 mangrove plant species, 70s are true mangrove species, and 10s are natural hybrids, and they form a diverse assemblage in the upper half of the intertidal zone, and which is situated at the interface of the land and sea. So mangroves are famous for its unique ecosystem services. So we are considering mangroves as a multi-valued, multi-billionaire ecosystem, and they provide immense services. Like mangrove deliver a range of economic, social and environmental benefits to people, and it is collectively referred to ecosystem goods and services. So if we categorize it ecosystem services, so it can be a provisioning, it can be a regulating and supporting, and it can be a cultural. For provisioning services, they provide us timbers, they provide us fuels, fisheries, they sustain a luxury and biodiversity, they act as a medicine, fodder and tannins. And if we look at its regulating and supporting services, it is famous for it controlling its climate regulation, coastal protection and shoreline stabilization. So these mangrove ecosystem in the land sea interface are saving the mainland like Kolkata. So in a nutshell, mangrove helps to maintain our water quality, regulate our climate by the uptake of pollutants, cycling of nutrients and sequestration of long-term storage of carbon. So if I talk about the mangrove status in India, so in a global scenario, India has a good place for its luxuriant mangrove diversity, and currently Forest Survey of India estimates suggest that India has near about 5,000 square kilometers of mangroves. And West Bengal has the largest share of the mangroves, accounting near 42.45% of mangroves in India, and it is covering more than 2,000 square kilometers. And in West Bengal, that the region holds a prestigious world largest contiguous transboundary mangrove ecosystem, the Sundarbans. So now I am introducing Sundarban. So as I shared earlier, that Sundarban is the world largest mangrove transboundary ecosystem shared between two countries, that is India and Bangladesh. And unfortunately, that Indian bird holds only 40% of mangrove cover of Sundarbans, and Bangladesh bird cover rest the 60%. And it is the only mangrove tiger land in the planet. That is its uniqueness. So if I talk about the only Indian part of Sundarban or Indian Sundarban Delta, so total area of Indian Sundarban is 9,630 square kilometer, and it includes protected areas started during British period. 4,263 square kilometers are the protected area network, which includes one national park called Sundarban National Park and four wildlife sanctuaries named Sajnekhali Wildlife Sanctuary, Luthian Sanctuary, Halliday Island Sanctuary, and recently emerging West Sundarban Wildlife Sanctuary. That our Sundarban is a pride of India. It's a national and as well as international importance. And these Sundarbans is a highly and heavily researched ecosystem. and it is crowned with several national and international feathers. Like in 1987, that UNESCO declared the protected area, which Sundarban National Park, as a World Heritage Site. Both part of Bengal Sundarbans in Indian Bangladesh are declared as a World Heritage Site by the UNESCO. In 2001, that Sundarban included as a man and biosphere reserve program and emerging as a Sundarban biosphere reserve as a whole. So total 9,630 square kilometer considered as a Sundarban biosphere reserve. And very recently in 2019, that Sundarban entire Sundarban wetland entire Sundarban protected area is designated as a Ramsar site. So it is a highly prestigious and highly pride ecosystem of national and international importance. So this is the current map of the Indian Sundarban ecoregion, where you can say the different protected area regime, that means national park, reserve forest, reclamation area, and the red border denoted the embankment, which is the lifeline of Sundarban, that I'll come later on. Now, I am just before entering the climate change narrative, I want to discuss about its uniqueness. Sundarban is famous for its unique abiotic biodiversity, and it supports a luxuriant biodiversity in terms of fauna. If you look at the left side of a map, Sundarbans cover nearly 90% of Indian mangrove species. So as this area are salt dominated, so these plants communities as a whole considered as a coastal halophytes. Sorry, and nearly 180 species of coastal halophytes are there, and in terms of exclusively mangrove diversity, Sundarban holds 33 unique species of mangroves. And it is pertinent to note that in Andaman and Nicobar Island, it holds the maximum number of mangrove species, that is 38 number of mangrove species, followed by our neighboring state Odisha, that holds 34 number of mangrove species, and West Bengal ranked third in terms of mangrove diversity, that is 33 number of mangrove species. So apart from the mangrove, true mangroves, often mangroves are classified as that entire communities are classified as a mangroves and mangrove associates. So we have a diverse range of mangrove associates, including salt marsh, our West Bengal coast sustain 12 number of salt marshes, and more than 40 numbers of mangrove associates are present in this ecoregion. More than 120 numbers of algae and numerous species of lichens. So these are the common mangrove species I want to share, that unique beautiful mangroves. And if you see the middle of the pictures, that is Sundari tree, Heritaria pomus, and it is probably the Sundarban name came from this plant called Sundari. It is a prestigious species of Sundarbans. And other species include that Gewa. They have different coloration in different environment, that Gorjon, Goran, Kakra, different species of vines, Hargoja. If you see the Hargoja, it is available plenty in Sundarbans. That Chak Kevda, if you see at the photograph, the Chak Kevda, the scientific name is Sunaraceae alba, and just 2 years before, this species also mistakenly known as Sunaraceae griffithi. So we have changed that taxonomic identity of this species, and this species now known as Sunaraceae alba. Now also the ecosystem sustains the unique species called Kalsi, and it is famous for Sundarban honey. That Kalsi honey, you all know that the Kalsi honey is very beautiful and tasty, white color of honey. Also, that is the fruit of Hetal, means phoenix, Golpata, and that picture is Golpata along with Kyaura, the two freshwater loving plant in Sundarbans and Tura. So this is the common mangrove species occurring in the Sundarban tidal delta. So now I am showing the mangrove dependent fauna of Sundarbans. When we are talking about Sundarbans, first the animal comes into the picture, that is the Bengal tiger, the Royal Bengal tiger, and it is the top of the apex of the food chain. And I am showing the some megafauna for your interest, like tigers. The second photograph is fishing cat. It is a state animal of West Bengal. Also the wild boar, spotted deer, axis, also the Bengal monitor, and in Bengali it is called, in Bangla it is called Sorno Bodhika, and also it is famous for largest estuary in crocodile, and also it sustains a unique species of some unique species of turtles, and you see that river terrapin, Batagur Baska, and also it's famous for its snake diversity. So apart from megafauna, vertebrate fauna, from a perspective of geologist, so Indian Sundarban is famous for its unique biotic resources, starting from protozoa, porifera to mammalia, and it holds a numerous molluscan species, very beautiful molluscan species, near about 177 number of species, so many commercial important crustaceans, mainly aquatic group of arthropods like crabs, lobsters, shrimps, barnacles, crayfish, etc. More than 30 number of fish species, and most are the commercially important and edible fish species, and some mouth-watering fish species, 71 numbers of reptiles, and 47 number of mammals. And also it is pertinent to note that Sundarban is famous for its bird biodiversity. It is famous for its native indigenous as well as migratory bird diversity, and nearly and a recent study found that from JSI that Sundarban holds more than 400 species of birds, including several migratory birds. And you know that often we are calling Sundarban as a kingfisher's paradise. In Bengali it is called Machranga. So out of 12 number of kingfishers found in worldwide, Sundarban holds nearly 9 species of kingfishers. So in real sense, it is really a kingfisher's paradise, I can say. So that is in a nutshell of that unique biotic parameters of Sundarbans. Now I am talking about the human dominated part of Sundarbans. As I said earlier, that Sundarban is a culmination of a protected area network as well as a settled area. So out of 100 odd islands, 54 number of islands are now densely populated, and currently 4.5 million of people, and mostly they are impoverished people in India. The habitated part of Sundarbans is distributed in two districts of Sundarbans, namely South 24 Parganas and North 24 Parganas, and it collectively it has 19 numbers of community development blocks, and we collectively called as a Sundarban blocks. So starting from westward, if I tell the name, so name are very familiar to you, like Sagar, Namkhana, Pathar Pratima, Kagdeep, Mathurapur 1, Mathurapur 2, Kultoli, Joynagar 1 and 2, Canning 1 and 2, Bashanti and Gosabad. These 13 blocks are from South 24 Parganas district, and rest 6 means Hingalganj, Sandeskali 1 and 2, Harwa, Minakha and Hashnabad are from North 24 Parganas. So that is the total 19 numbers of Sundarban blocks. So from colonial times, Sundarban is dominated by rain-fed agriculture as well as paddy fish farming, and currently is transformed to aquaculture. So agriculture and aquaculture is the mainstay of the occupation, mainstay of the livelihood, and the significant drivers of the economy. But in Sundarbans, instead of rapid development in agriculture sector rest of the part of the world, but Sundarbans agriculture still in the primitive, because it's low irrigation intensity and it's low cropping intensity. Also, aquaculture also is very primitive one, due to multiple number of stresses, and human development index is very poor in Indian Sundarbans, and currently 34% of population is the under the below poverty line. And recent DECMA project estimates that economic necessity drives near 20% of working adults to seek employment outside their village in the name of migration. So and after the super cyclone Ayla in 2009, the migration is very prominent, is very, very prominent. So now if I look at the more intense, so if I look at the villages around the Sundarban Tiger Reserve, within this Sundarban Biosphere Reserve, so northern and western fringes of Sundarban Tiger Reserve sustains a high density of human habitation, and more than 1,000 square kilometer is the population density. There are 46 number of revenue villages, and there are 2.7 million of people lives in the fringe area. So it is pertinent to note that there are no forested villages inside the Sundarbans. So all are fringe villages. So you can say it's a revenue villages. And compared to the Bangladesh part, in Bangladesh part, no villages are there in the Sundarban landscape. And if we look at the population around Sundarban Tiger Reserve especially, the communities are historically underprivileged, and more than 40% belongs to SC and ST category. Their land holding is very less, having a very low literacy rate, lack of proper technical skills and employment opportunities. So all these led to a high degree of natural resource dependency, and more than 80% inhabitants of this particular area depends on the NTFPs, means non-timber based forest products like fish, honey, wax, and other extraction method. So really, in a true sense, so these vulnerable people, often called in Bangla in the Bader Dharel Lok, Chorel Lok, Sundarbonel Lok, it's really vulnerable and impecunious communities of the West Bengal as well as India. So I just want to share some livelihood instrument of that area, and you know we are called, it's a heritage profession, that fishing, that fish hunting, honey collection, and other extraction method. It's a heritage library food of fringe population of Sundarbans, and so many women and men are actively engaged to earn their livelihood from these unique and diverse ecosystem. That left side of pictures is showing that min collection means stream seed catching from the Sundarbans. So it is a prominent livelihood of so many peoples of Sundarbans. And the right side the lower picture is showing the honey collection inside the tiger habitat. And Sundarban is considered as a global hotspot of human animal conflict, mainly human tiger conflict as well as human crocodile conflict, and so many people are taken away by tiger during the honey collection particular. So often we called it is a blood honey. So this is a nutshell about the Sundarban, its environment, its people. But today's topic is the climate change. So now I am entering in the narrative of climate change. So before entering the narrative of climate change, I want to clear between two things. Let me clear you that there is a difference between climate and weather. So if you look at the weather, weather refers as a short-term atmospheric conditions, while climate is the weather of specific region averaged over a long period of time. So then climate change is referred as a long-term changes of weather and climate phenomena in a particular given area. So Sundarban is considered as a global hotspot of climate change. So if you look at the global scenario, that Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, the international institution who are responsible for managing managing the climatic data over the world and make a climate inclusive policies. So that IPCC predicts that global warming is likely to reach 1.5 degrees centigrade between 2030 and 2052 if the current trend continues. If we talk about the Indian perspective, India ranked fifth in the global climatic risk index in 2019, and in 2019 IPCC published a special report on global warming, and IPCC warned that India would experience increased number of hot days, prolonged summer, severe precipitation events, means severe rainfall events, floods and droughts, tropical cyclones and coastal flooding, which will expose an already vulnerable population to extreme poverty, more hunger and livelihood insecurity. So if we narrowed down the narrative into our East Coast, East Coast of India is one of the sixth most cyclone prone areas in the world, where the Sundarbans is situated. And it is pertinent to note that our neighboring state Odisha, in Odisha coast, it is also vulnerable for a climate change impact. And I am sharing an interesting fact here, that in the context of Odisha, although Odisha share only 18% of east coast of India, it shares 35% tropical 35% share of tropical cyclones and other environment related catastrophes that passed over that part of Bay of Bengal. So if you look at the inter-Asian region, so our Asian region is really vulnerable for sea level rise and other climatic diverse. And if we talk about the Indian Sundarban in particular, so in the Indian Sundarbans is not only Indian Sundarban, the both part of Sundarbans of the Bengal is vulnerable for increasing in air temperature, increasing in sea surface temperature that is abbreviated as SST, changes in rainfall and precipitation pattern, changes in salinity regime that is a slow poison in that area, occurrence of extreme weather events and coastal flooding, coastal erosion and land loss, and finally loss of mangroves. So now I want to discuss the some parameters of some climatic parameters that has been changing over time in Sundarbans. So if we look at the annual temperature anomaly, so annual mean surface air temperature over Bay of Bengal, where the Sundarban is situated, has warmed around 0.7 degree centigrade during 1900 to the current 2018. And scientists are predicting that if the trend continues, the air temperature in this area is expected to rise by 1 degree centigrade by 2050. So it is really a frightening thing. If we consider SST, means sea surface temperature over the Bay of Bengal, so SST is increasing more rapidly than the other global oceans. The average SST over Sundarban region have increased from 30 degrees centigrade to 32 degrees centigrade between 1980 to 2007, and which is increasing a 0.5 degrees centigrade per decade. Another study concerning sea surface temperature over Bay of Bengal predicts that it has risen by 1 degree centigrade on average over 1951 to 2015. So all these exerted in the global warming phenomena and contributing the entire warming of this delta. And if we look at the rainfall pattern, so rainfall are showing a very erraticness in nature. So so rainfall of monsoon and post monsoon showed a decreasing trend, while the pre monsoon rainfall showed an increasing trend. So it is a important features of rainfall anomalies over Sundarban over time. And if you look at the graphs, I just pasted that that average changes of annual temperature and rainfall of South 24 Parganas and North 24 Parganas of Sundarban region, and you can say that the very erraticness nature of temperature and rainfall since 1900 to the present decade. So if we look at the extreme weather events, that is a very important thing for the present context. Extreme weather events means cyclones, storm surges, etc. So we are now experiencing Yaas cyclone and the image of Yaas cyclone in our mind is very new. So I am sharing some interesting fact about the weather events here. So research is showing that pre and post monsoonal storms are more violent than the storms of the monsoonal season. Over last 120 years, the Bay of Bengal region registered 26% increase of severe cyclonic storms, and that is intensifying in the post-monsoonal period. So if we look at last two decades, in the last two decades, the entire Bay of Bengal region of Indian Ocean has been experienced more than 20 number of such climatic events. But one interesting fact that although there is a significant reduction in annual frequency of tropical cyclones over Bay of Bengal, a significant reduction, but there is a increase in frequency of very severe cyclonic storms like Yaas and Phailin kind of thing in the post monsoon period during 2000 and 2018. And recent one, the World Bank study depict that they have analyzed near about 168 number of storms from 1877 to 2016 in the northern part of the Bay of Bengal coast, including Odisha. And the research saying that the median location of cyclones has shifted eastward over time, with the highest impact zones currently found in the northern part of the Odisha coast and Sundarban region of the West Bengal. So if you look at the graph, that how that pattern, how that median value of that cyclone has been changing from 900 to 2016. Now I want to share some graphical representation of the anomalies of the extreme weather events. So if you look at the two decades, means 2000 to 2010 and then 2010 to 2020 or 21, in the past decade, that entire the Bay of Bengal region, including the Sundarban region, has witnessed the four mega cyclones called Cedar, Nargis, Bijli and Ayla, and it has intensified both in the pre-monsoon period during April and May, as well as during September to October and September to November. And these cyclones are categorized as extremely severe cyclonic storm, like Nargis and Cedar, like severe cyclonic storm like Ayla. And if you look at the cyclonic pattern or cyclonogenesis after 2010, after 2010, that northern part of the Bay of Bengal have witnessed five number of mega cyclone considering Yaas. So in 2013, Phailin, it's an extremely severe cyclonic storm, followed by 2019, two cyclones, Phoni, that is also extremely severe cyclonic storm, as well as Bulbul. Bulbul is considered as a very severe cyclonic storm. And just last 2 years, 2020 and 2021, the memories are very new in our mind, that in 25th May, that Sundarban is struck by Amphan. It is categorized as a severe cyclonic storm, and in 25th May, that very in 2021, the very severe cyclonic storm Yaas. So not only all the extreme weather events posed hazards to that in the Sundarbans, because of some cyclones are just touching and narrowing crossed narrowly through Sundarbans, but if we consider the three mega cyclones called Ayla and Ayla in 25th May in 2009, in that Amphan 20th May in 2020, and Yaas to 25th May, all are intensifying in the pre-monsoon May. You see that very severe tropical cyclone Yaas in 25th May in 2021. So these all posing a great hazards in the Sundarban ecosystem, as well as people, livelihood, infrastructure, everything. Another straightening fact is the sea level rise, because global warming and subsequent temperature increasing is aggravating the scenarios of sea level rise. And you know, for the Sundarban perspective, we called it relative mean sea level rise. So in a past study, that relative mean sea level rise in Sundarbans and its adjoining Bay of Bengal was 3.14 millimeter per year, and that is a far higher than the global average of sea level, which is 1.7 millimeter per year. So current rate of sea level is more, sea level of Sundarban is higher than the other parts of the India as well as the other parts of the world. And the tidal waves and tidal surges is the regular phenomena of the Sundarbans. So tidal waves are sometime may go up to 7.5 meter high. Can you imagine? And which may further increase during cyclone and extreme weather events. And for the Sundarban language, we called it's a kotal, bharak kotal. So these extreme sea level projections for that Ganga Brahmaputra Meghna Basin show an increased likelihood of high water event through the 21st century, partly due to that delta not having that enough sediment for maintenance its current elevation relative to the sea level. And in 2019, that Unnikrishnan et al. Have measured that net sea level rise in the five station based on the tidal gauge data of Karachi, Pakistan, Mumbai, Kochi, Visakhapatnam, and Diamond Harbor near Sundarbans, and they found it's a high than the other parts of the other region, that is 5.74. So net sea level rise is 5.7 millimeter per year is happening in Sundarbans. So that storm surges, that sea level, that climate change induced sea level rise, coastal hazards poses a serious coastal erosion over the two parts of the delta. And if you see at the upper picture, you can I am giving the both part of the delta, and the area has been shrinking over time. If you look at the graph, then from the 1900 to current day, the erosion and accretion, although erosion accretion is a some part is natural phenomena, but it is happening in the current century largely due to climate change. And in that image, you can see the red part is the erosion and the dark green part is the accretion. So if we look at the data over Indian Sundarbans, so from 2001 to 2008, the region suffered a net land loss of nearly 4,500 hectare due to the coastal erosion and 5.5 square kilometer of coastal erosion per year. So we are losing 5.5 square kilometer of chunk of soil or area per year from Sundarbans. If we talk about the embankment, so out of nearly 4,000 square kilometer of embankments over entire Indian Sundarbans, the vulnerable embankments gone more than 1,000 square kilometer after the post ILA periods. So it can be mentioned that embankment is the lifeline of Sundarbans. So these century-old man-made embankments are meant for protecting the coastal waters, and these embankments make possible agriculture and existence of freshwater aquaculture inside the Sundarban island. So if breaches of embankment happened and coastal water floods the entire inside the Sundarban island, which is basically a freshwater domain. So that subsequent sea level rise and coastal erosion already vanished and inundated four habitated islands over Sundarban in the past 2 decades, and the islands are named as Bedford, Lohachara, and Kasabkadi and Supadi Vanga, and rendered near about 6,000 families homeless. And in our recent years, that three any issue in network, in my network or what?
In our network, sir, actually.
Okay.
You can start, sir.
Okay. So, sorry for the troubling. I am discussing the flood level, the projected flood level in the entire region, and you can see the red color that areas are vulnerable of coastal flooding in 2015, and it is the medium likelihood scenario. And this kind of coastal flooding will pose a massive salinity intrusion into the freshwater mainland of the Sundarbans and other delta, like Mahanadi delta of Odisha. If we look at the salinity regime over Sundarbans, so salinity is varying across the region due to the scarcity of freshwater flows and the ingestion of sea water, and salinity in the eastern sector has increased 6 ppt, it's a unit gram per liter, over the past 3 decades, means 2 ppt per decade, which is also much higher than the documented average in the Indian Ocean. So salinity is causing a serious threats to the life and livelihoods of people, as well as the biodiversity of Indian Sundarbans. I'll discuss in later slide. So these all are the climatic impacts that is posing a serious threat over Sundarbans, mainly increasing temperature, the rainfall anomalies, frequency and intensity of severe cyclonic storms, intrusion of salinity and coastal erosion. So now, what are the consequences of climate change in Indian Sundarbans in the present, in the context of present day? So if we look at the entire Sundarban in a landscape narrative, so if we divide, we can divide the Sundarban landscape into three broad narrative, like physical landscape, like socio-economic and cultural landscape, and biological landscape, as you see in this slide. So what are the impact on the physical landscape? It's a damage of embankments, it's a serious issue, loss of physical assets and infrastructures, impacts of drinking water, impacts of sanitation, impacts on health in infrastructure, etc. They're damaging the physical landscape of the delta. If you talk the socio-economic and livelihood landscape of the Delta, the climate change pose a serious threats on agriculture. It has a serious impact on aquaculture due to ingression of saline water into freshwater area, mainly freshwater agriculture area and freshwater pond, as I said earlier. It causes reducing in fishing days who are performing wild fishing. It caused loss of havoc, damage of livestock, which is also a major economic activities of Sundarbans, and it causes a loss of other livelihoods and so that the people have to opt the migration as a economic tool for sustaining their life. And also there is a emerging health problem just aftermath of cyclone. Just yesterday I received one information from Sagar Island that after going down of the cyclone water from the area, from the house and others, already there is a prevalent of diarrheal and cholera disease over the island. And this is the phenomenon of not only Sagar Island and the maximum island from the Sundarbans. And if we look at the biological landscape, it has a and climate change really pose a serious threats on the biological landscape. In particular, it includes loss of habitat and wildlife. It changes in species composition. It causes a salinity stress on native freshwater species. It invites new kind of pests and diseases on the agriculture and aquaculture system, and most importantly, transboundary pests and diseases for fishery and aquaculture sector. And overall, it deteriorates the entire aesthetic environment of the Delta. So if we look at the top view, so climate change is challenging food and nutrition security by disrupting the chains of food access, availability, distribution and utilization of food in a complex way. It is pertinent to note that we are not in a good India is not in a good position in the food and nutrition index globally, and recently published National Health Family Survey data revealed a striking fact that some states are still suffering the dual burden of malnutrition. So climate change further aggravating this situation and challenging the food and nutrition security of the Delta and exposing already vulnerable people to a extreme poverty, hunger and malnutrition. So I am showing that pictures. So nowadays the media, the print media, social media, electronic media is very active in collecting this kind of hazardous picture, and I have collected from different sources. So just see, look at the condition of house completely submerged by the water, the agriculture land, farmland is completely devastating by the cyber, that coastal water, that saline water, and also the damage of embankment. That is a very heart touching picture, came from Sagar Island and Ghoramara, and you see that the maximum people of Ghoramara Island, that is under the Gram Panchayat of Sagar Island, under the it's a Gram Panchayat of Sagar Island, that already a sizable population left Ghoramara and left their belongings, and just see that pictures how they carried their livestock in the boat, and they are now and they are going towards the Sagar Island, and by vacating their homeland, their ancestral land. If you look at the right side of pictures, that is picture came from Sagar Island from one of my colleague, his name is Jolad Gayan, and you see that entire house is submerged by the coastal water, and And it is very sad to say that the house of Jalatgayan is devastating, has devastated by the past cyclone Amphan, and his family is still suffering recovering the damage of Amphan. Again years struck his house. So that is not a condition of Jalatgayan itself. It's a story of millions in Sundarbans. So that is the pictures from the disaster response and post cyclone disaster preparedness and relief and you know that in the entire climate change narrative, that women and children are the most vulnerable counterpart of the human system because of their low adaptation capacity. But it is very good that we don't have to lose faith over Bengali people, because so many Bengali people extended their hands and stands with Sundarbans and give solidarity for the Sundarban people, and it's a really a very very good sign of the citizen involvement in the climatic services as well as disaster responses over Sundarbans. It is really very good thing that citizen participation in the disaster management. So now if we look at the threat of the biological system, means mangroves and its associated fauna, so not only climate change is only threats to mangrove. So mangroves are very vulnerable with a quantum number of drivers, like rapid coastal development, pollution, aquaculture, agriculture, conversion of agriculture land, conversion of mangrove land to agriculture, tree cutting, etc. And globally, if you consider in a global scale, the aquaculture causes more than half of the mangrove losses globally, mostly due to shrimp aquaculture. So please think before eat shrimp. And now the picture is very prominent after 2009, when that Litopinia's venami farming is allowed over West Bengal and Sundarbans. So there are number of threats that increasing vulnerability of mangroves, and you know that climate change also posing a threat to mangrove ecosystem. That air temperature, rainfall regime, and salinity changing, the changes in salinity causing a changes of distribution of global mangrove species, and often led to local and regional extinction of mangrove species. If you look at the right side of pictures, you can see that how the mangrove density or how the mangrove cover has been changed over time. So starting from 1776 to 2014, we lost a chunk of mangroves, and that is very evident from that pictures. If we look at the entire mangrove ecosystem through the entire the transboundary delta perspective, so it is pertinent to note that ecosystem cannot be divided by a political boundaries. So ecosystem should be considered as a single chunk, single entity. Single entity of ecosystem. So I want to share that map. You can see the different layer. That last layer, that red layer, is the current Sundarbans, and how that mangrove density has been changed over time. And the rampant mangrove conservation happened during British period, and you know that British are the major culprit for damaging mangrove the entire Bengal Delta, and also Sundar. If you look at the historical perspective, that Sundarbans is ruled by several regime, like Bengal Sultanate, that Mughals, then British, and after partition the present day Sundarbans, and that map is showing the changes of mangrove cover from 1776 to 2010. So if we narrow down the climate impact on particularly in mangroves, so it has some regional consequences, and in our part the mangroves of Indian Sundarbans are facing a freshwater scarcity because of changes and reduction of freshwater flow by the due to clogging of freshwater rivers in the eastern part, and while the western part of Sundarbans has a luxuriant freshwater supply, and that freshwater scarcity over the eastern and central part in Sundarbans causing changes in the species composition of freshwater loving species like Sundari and Golpata. If you look at the Bangladesh part, they have plenty of fresh water, and their Sundari trees, hills are fabulous, fantastic. When you compared in the Indian part of Sundarbans, that our Sundari trees are not so much healthy than the Odisha and Bangladesh part. So at present, that salt tolerant mangrove species are dominating in these Sundarban parts, like Phoenix, Xylocarpus, Egiceras kind of mangrove compositions are emerging out. Abyssinia are emerging out in the entire delta. If you see at the map of the different color code of species. So not only the changes of species composition is the consequence of climate change, it is also causing damaging of mangrove seed that is important for the mangrove natural regeneration of increase in mangrove cover in the delta. In the past cyclone Amphan in 2020, that there is a huge scarcity of mangrove seed for plantation, because that mangrove plant because the quantum of seeds have been damaged by that super cyclone. Also, another consequences of climate change is the top dying disease of Sundari and other trees and pest attacks. Most importantly, that climate change is changing the phenology of the mangrove species. Phenology means the flowering and fruiting pattern of the species. And one interesting fact I want to share, that due to changing pattern of the flower and phenology, that already increase in honey production is evident over Sundarbans. So it is compromising the quality of honey, but it increase in quantity. So climate change has both positive and negative impacts on the system. If you look at the fish breeding, that prolonged summer has a positive impact on fish breeding, like the that honey production is increasing due to that changes species composition and prolonged summer. Now that look at the two graph very careful, two images very carefully. So it is the active tidal delta of the Indian part comprising 25 number of community development block, considering Baduria, including Sundarban 19 blocks and other blocks like Bushirat 1, Bushirat 2, Baduria, and Rajarhat and Bhangar. So just see the blue part, that how the aquaculture has been increased over time since 1985 to 2020, and how they expand the entire aquaculture landscape over Sundarbans, and this is largely due to conversion of mangrove land to aquaculture. And also, if we look at the last 2-3 decades, that mangrove cover in Sundarbans has been increasing due to tremendous effort by government, private sectors and NGOs for mangrove plantation effort. Mangrove cover in Sundarbans is increasing due to this effort. Now I am sharing one interesting fact here, that in that upper region, that Bushirhat, Harwa and others, where that very culture, that stream culture is prevalent, and if you look at the 100 years ago, this area is dominated by paddy cum fish farming. Now it transformed as a stream based polyculture, but farmers are now experiencing less salinity in that region. So previously I said salinity is the slope poison, so it has a different dimension in different corners in Sundarbans and posing different kind of impacts and threats over the biotic and socio-economic landscape over the delta. So this is some consequences of climate change on wildlife. I have collected these pictures from the Sundarban Biosphere Reserve, that one tiger has passed away that during that cyclone period. Here you can say one forest official trying to save life of a little deer. And also the climate change also damaging the management infrastructure over Sundarbans, like it damaged havoc the conservation effort of the vulnerable Batagaur Basta conservation. Also some parts of fencing has been damaged due to that cyclone. So climate change has also negative influence on the wildlife management as well as wildlife as a whole. So now from both part of Sundarbans, there is a call for resilient and concrete river embankment. It is very very need based thing at the present context, because so many people are suffering due to that extreme catastrophes, and we should think in a better way, in a holistic way. So I am just coming to last in my presentation. So we have to think more climate inclusive futures for the betterment of Sundarbans. You know, so we have a well developed early warning system. We have multi-purpose cyclone shelter. Government is doing a tremendous job for the people of the Sundarbans, and there is a very active disaster response team. There is a multi-institutional participation in disaster management, etc. But still something we are lacking for the inclusive management to battle against climate change induced impacts. So to address the resultant livelihood crisis that crippling the lives of people in the region, it is critical to shift the focus from shorter term relief involving the distribution of food grains and items like tarpaulins or engineering solutions such as reconstruction of roads and embankments, to shift from the short term to that medium and long term approaches targeting economic self-reliance through skill building. So we need an inclusive climate futures for the Sundarbans, and which must focus on both ecosystem and economic self-reliance. So I am just want to share some short term, mid term and long term building blocks for the development that can help for a better management to resist climatic impacts. See, mangrove conservation is the central theme of the Sundarban. So conservation and protection of existing mangroves is Solomon bin factor in the current context. Also upgrading the current embankments also a serious thing. Improving the water management and irrigation and drainage capacity also it is a need of the hour after the post cyclone part. We need a durable and saline resistant infrastructure. We have to adopt climate smart agriculture and aquaculture practice. Sundarban is famous for its native salt tolerant varieties. So we have to popularize again salt tolerant varieties. We have to opt for integrated multi-trophy aquaculture kind of thing for to culture finfish and brackishwater shellfish in a combined manner. We have to go for vertical farming. We have to go for resilient house system, etc. So that we can enhance the entire capacity of the people of the Sundarban so that they can cope with that extreme events. See, we can't resist the such kind of extreme catastrophes, but we can minimize their impact. We can minimize their loss by taking a holistic and more inclusive climate adaptation approach. So I just want to share two, three things about restoration of mangroves because today is World Environment Day and our theme is the generation restoration. So I said earlier that since 1980, Sundarban experienced a rapid mangrove plantation venture and so many government NGOs and etc. They are doing very good job on mangrove plantation, but I have complete respect on that issue. But we have to think how to increase the natural resiliency of that system. How we can increase the natural regeneration and natural restoration of mangroves? See, so many organizations are doing mangrove plantation. Okay. So mangrove plantation is not just planting a mangroves. So it involves a series of thing like selection of proper site. It has a wide established science and its biophysical and soil and water properties, suitable locally available mangrove species, and development of mangrove nurseries, plantation design, physical protection of plantation site, post-plantation monitoring, etc. See, one of the important thing is post-plantation care and monitoring. So if you plant rupees 1 crore of plantation and if you left in a vacant, so one goat is enough to destroy your rupees 1 crore plantation in one day. So we need to adopt some community based mangrove management, and several NGOs have seen the success by adopting the community based mangrove management in the Sundarbans, and also that you have to empower the women group. Because women has the tremendous power, and if you raise capacity of that women group, that overall resiliency of the system is improved. So you have to design some women inclusive mangrove management policies that is often reluctant from our policies perspective. So making a women stewardship can show a great success of community based mangrove restoration and worldwide at present worldwide mangrove so called mangrove plantation is discouraged now. I'd say, but mangrove restoration where you can give their ecological process so that they can grow by itself in its own environment is now encouraging day by day. And in our Sundarbans, there is a huge potential of natural regeneration. So we have to think in that way. So this is my last slide. We all know from Kolkata we are sitting and seeing the Amphan, and yes, we are taking pictures in mobile and videos and sharing to WhatsApp, Facebook, but we should not forget that due to Sundarbans, so that we are here. So Sundarbans act as a bio wall so that we are safe in the cosmopolitan area. So nature is pressing a reset button day by day is regular manner. So we should very careful, and if you respect nature, she will care for you. So thank you enough. I just finished my presentation and now the house is open for discussion if any, and I'll try to address your concern as per my ability and as per my capacity. Thank you again, sir. Over to you, sir.
So is there any question from the audience side?
I think hello. in your presentation only four persons are there. If you make that YouTube live, is there any question? I can see it. So
from the audience side, is there any question? You may put. Dr. Dubey will try to answer it. If there is no question, then I can switch off and let me give the vote of thanks. It is my duty to express this. At the end of this program, on behalf of Birla Industrial and Technological Museum and SAFE, South Asian Forum for Environment, I express my thanks and gratitude to Dr. Saurabh Dubey for delivering his illuminating lecture, by which I hope everybody is enlightened. My thanks also goes to the students as well as other dignitaries who are present with us. So, is there any question from audience side? Is there? Okay. And my thanks also goes to SAFE, who have joined their hands with us, by which this program has become successful. My thanks also goes to our director, Sri S. Ramachandran, whose support and inspiration has made this program a grand success. My thanks, the last but not the least, my thanks goes to Sri Gautam Seel, Technical Officer of Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, and also my other colleagues whose cooperation has made this program a grand success. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you once again, Mr. Dr. Dubey.
Thank you too, sir. Mr. Mukherjee, also Mr. Seel, and also yes. I pay my sincere gratitude to our honorable director, Shire, And also, I want to thank the organizers and also South Asian Forum for Environment, mainly Roktima and Dipayan De and Professor Deepak Mondal.
Thank you, sir.
So thank you again, sir.